river vessels are. And as I told, it is going to be connected only from the beginning of the 12th century to the end of the 14th century. This is the poster of the exhibition. And on my presentation on the... here is the link of this YouTube. And on the left, it is... Rome style, Italy style, Latinian style, but also there are a lot of influence from the north, from Russia, from Georgia, from Azerbaijan. There is a lot of similar things in Serbian fresco art, for example, with Azerbaijan kind of things of art in fresco. And much more also in everyday art that can be used by women, for example, and so on. So I will not mention all the manuscripts, just the main one. First of them, manuscripts to Denica. On each slide, when I mention the manuscript, I put some of the main famous fresco painting or some details connected with that church, and also the photo of the church from the internet. So, Studenica, it is at the very beginning of the 12th century, founded by Stefan Nemanja. And there are actually two churches, the Church of the Holy Mother and the Church of St. Nicholas. Also, Monastery Žiča, very famous. All of you were able to visit it at least once during your life. And it is the beginning of 13th century, founded by Stefan Nemanjić, who was the first king of Serbia. And but actually it is very hard to follow this kind of information because a lot of them during the time of the history have been renewed in some particular point of time. They have been destroyed and after that built again or fixed. So we cannot follow just the time when it was founded, because the way of art and what has been used in fresco art has been changed accordingly to restoration things and so on. So Manastir Žiča was renewed in 14th century by King Milutin. Also very famous one, Studenica, King's Church, founded by King Milutin. There are plenty of church connected with this style that has been used as Studenica, like Holy Mother of Ljeviš, Brčanica, Gorčan Žič, and so on. So this is the similar kind of paint art that has been used in this church. Also, I will switch now on, the church of Mother Neviška, so it is also in Kosovo, a very beautiful one. The one that we are all of us are very proud of, but unfortunately we can not go freely go where? Monastery Peć Patriarcha. And there was the seat of Serbian bishop in Patriarch. And it is founded in 13th century. And there is a plenty of beautiful artworks in this church. Of course, because it was the seat of Serbian bishops and patriarch, of course, but also the beautiful fresco art in all monasteries on Kosovo. This is my favorite, I think, Holy Mother of Ljeviš. Also, this sign was used as the motif of the exhibition. Actually, we have two wings. They are going together, and it is a very, very beautiful motif by itself. And it is built on an old church, which is dating in 11th century. But actually, the Church of Holy Mother of Ljeviš was founded in at the beginning of 14th century, and a lot of actually very beautiful ornaments, example of ornaments, and also roses can be found there. And it's really famous because there are plenty of very unusual kind of paintings, unusual kind of ornaments, unusual kind of motifs in this church. You can recognize, of course, that it is not connected only with Serbia. Eagles are usual symbol of the kingdoms in many countries, not only in Serbia. Also, Manastir Brčanica, also in Kosovo, which has been founded by the king of sorry, I didn't translate it. My king is the Rutin. It is 10 kilometers only from Pristina. It is built on the site of the old episcopate of Lipnia. So plenty of them are actually built on the old previous one which had been there. For example, this motif you have on the card, I think also the upper one, but this one is very beautiful. I would just mention, we didn't deal with the fresco paintings and ornaments from Hilander on Athos in Greece, that simply it was not included in this exhibition. Several years ago, there was an exhibition which was only about the Hilander art. So on this exhibition, it was not included. So I will not speak about it. Even this is, there are some examples, very beautiful, very colorful, and very interesting from ornamental art point of view. But for some other time, because to stay. Hilander and also Monastery Gračanica are connected and under the influence of Bizan, for example, while the Rosarian style is more under the influence of Latin style, of style from the West. So you can follow also the information connected with the history of art, political kind of things, who is connected, in which period of time, with which country, what is going on, so the exchange of the artist, far involved from king's houses and church, of course, to do some work. So it is very interesting to make cooperation between two things and doing things together. So it is also connected with Macedonia. It is the monastery of Lesnovo, emperor the great Dušan, and the fresco of him and his wife. Some example of Moravian style, it is Drvarica, but of course it is written that it is found, of course, by Knez Lazar and Mekina Milica at the end of 14th century. Some of these motifs, especially roses, which can be found in architecture kind of building styles, dating a little bit later than these dates. Also, I have to mention the Bostonia, which is 9 meters from Dunajska Banja, with very beautiful fresco art paintings and very beautiful roses. So, for example, I put it here just to see how it is organized by the people who are dealing in history of art. So you must have information about the church. You have to all the information about what you're talking about, who is on the picture, and so on. Also to do all the measurement things, and also to give the sketch of the artwork without any color, so that all the motifs can be easily recognized. Also, yes, very beautiful, Manasia, endowment of despot Stefan Lazarevich, the beginning of 15th century, with beautiful, really beautiful ornaments. This one can be found on those postcards that I mentioned before. And after this, we are starting with a different kind of monastery. I will stop here with this survey through the monastery of Serbia. This Kalinić, beginning of 15th century. This is something that going in the middle age art, connected with a lot of details in the windows. But this is interesting kind of thing that I will mention before, how to produce ornaments, what is the connection between friezes and ornaments, and how with a simple repetition of friezes you can produce ornaments like this. So this was just a survey through the history of our church, a little bit, just to find out what we're talking about and what period of time. And now a little bit about ornaments. Ornament means decoration, and it is the oldest and basic decorative element in visual art during the history of time, during the history of art. It is closely connected to the concept of repetition, and moreover with the concept of symmetry, of course. It can be realized that artists of different cultures and different civilizations use the repetition of combination of different kinds of motifs, as we were able to see, to produce different kinds of decorative patterns that are called ornaments. But it is not only connected with frescoes or with the clothes, it can be also found on the bone, on the textile, on the ceramic, paintings, jewelry, even today, jewelry design, Milan, I guess, and so on. So the spectrum of motifs used in design with some kind of naturalistic and stylized representation of plants and animals at the beginning. After that, it was more connected with geometry. So I will speak about it a little bit later, but for example, you can make a different kind of classification of ornament due to the motif that has been used. And there are some of the, let's say, mathematical kind of motifs that are used, and we call them, like in psychology or something like that, archetype symbols, because they are connected with the well-known world way of thinking of that kind of science. For example, the circle in old culture during the time, it is connected with motion, with no beginning or no end, the sign of infinity, eternity, perfection, God, sun. So when you say the circle, it is something perfect. And about, for example, the spiral, is very popular because on the contrary of the circle, is more connected with development, with moving, develops from one point. More than a circle, it is symbol of motion, of the rising sun, of the growth, of the life, and so on. Also the double spiral, the symbol of death, and life, good and evil, it is a kind of cosmic symbol. And I didn't put on this slide, but there are a lot of plenty of other motifs like square, triangle, hexagram. Actually, this regular geometric shapes have been used, and they are connected with the meaning of numbers. But we will not go into that now. But for example, square is very stubborn kind of thing. While the triangle, it depends how we want to use. Is it a male or female sign? Is it going to put it like this? Or to put it like this? Do we want them to be stable or to be just connected with one point? So this is female, this is male. So let's say a few words about geometry and paintings. Because from one side they are very connected during the history of time, history of art. But from the other side, they are using two completely different languages and different terms for describing symmetrical forms, and both of them using the same kind of forms, but cannot understand, but it is not the same language. So you have a kind of feeling that there are two different kind of things, but they are not. Even more, the first significant statement for the study of ornamental art came from mathematicians. It was connected with the theory of symmetry, and also it was connected with classification and analysis of ornament which are based on symmetry. And there are plenty of scientists and mathematicians and crystallographers who were working on that, like Miller, Shepard, Mello, Dorothy Washburn, Donald Crow, Branko Grunwald, and so on. And they introduced the crystallography terminology. Why crystallography? Because it is in really close relation with crystals and chemistry and the structure of molecules, atoms, and so on. So the Zoom tool is a tool to produce such a kind of model. And it is connected with symmetry and with repetition in some particular kind of way. This is one example In the book, Theorie der Gruppen, this is pattern specific kind of type. I will talk a little bit later about it. And the author is Andreas Speiser. And he was the first one who proposed to use ornaments from ancient world, like Egyptian ornament. And that maybe, he proposed to use it as the best possible illustration of symmetry groups. And it was done in 1927. Speiser's student, Edith Müller, she applied this idea of classification of ornaments from Alhambra, which is maybe the most famous place for his investigation of ornament. It has been done in 1944, and in her work we can find illustration for 13 from 17 possible plain ornaments. And on the left, there is one example of Alhambra patterns. It is of the type B4G. We will see later what does it mean. And plenty of the collection of the whole collection of ornaments can be found in the book. I think there is some electronic form of this. Jones' Grammar of Ornament, which has been done in 19th century, actually 1856. And I'm happy to have this collection. And it is very nice. So, we have the approach to the ornaments that are from the point of view of the theory of symmetry and from the point of view of the history of art. And actually, we propose to mix these two things in order to get the best possible results and classification and everything. So there is a possibility for studying ornamental art regularities and laws on which construction of ornaments are based. And also the geometry and symmetry groups can help us to find efficient method for the classification and comparative analysis, and also very important for the reconstruction of the ornaments. Also, there is some interesting other, which is not here, connection or better say, some investigation done by psychologists. It is connected with Gestalt psychology. That actually there were some investigation how we can remember some pictures. And the most usual and the most fast process is connected with mirror symmetry things. That you can very easily memorize this kind of photos and pictures that have mirror symmetry. And actually, the story is about what is about the ornamental art, why we mostly all people found it nice, beautiful. We just like to look at these different kinds of ornaments and motifs, and even try to find out how it is constructed, actually. And it is because the visual perception of this ornament are kind of inviting us to recognize the rules. And actually, very interesting things is that at first glance, we don't go deep into the details. We just want to have the overall picture of the things, trying to recognize is there any vertical or horizontal line of symmetry or something like that. And after that, we will deal with some details. But what we are going to look at first, even in, it was the 0.1 seconds to recognize if there is any vertical symmetry on the picture. And it is also connected with, let's say, investigation. If you ask yourself how these ornaments can be transferred, you can make sketches or by memorizing patterns, and then to reproduce by remembering what? First the symmetry and then the motif. And actually, you're going to change a little bit the motif but you're going to remember the symmetry of the ornaments that you want to reproduce. So there is a plenty of different kinds of ornaments with the same symmetry, even they look very different. Even when you are producing, reproducing the ornaments, you can make some changes, but actually more or less it is going to be the same symmetry, but the motif is going to be a little bit changed. Let's see what is the classification from point of view of history of art. Mostly this classification is connected with the different kinds of motifs. So it is more about descriptive classification of patterns. Their division into zoomorphic, plant, floral, geometrical. So here you can see the list of classification which has been used by Zagorka Jantz on 1950 when she wrote the first book about ornamental art in Serbia. And she used the investigation that has been done before that in different countries. But she said that she must add some new motifs that she found in Serbia. What is logical, because in each area you can find some specific kind of plants or motifs that are recognized by the people who are living there. So they are logically included in ornamental art. So, what was their proposition? The ornaments composed of the zigzag lines. What are zigzag lines? Just like teeth. The ornaments composed the underlying lines and tapes. The ornament composed of circles, the egg-shaped stick, the ornaments developed of the Cufic alphabet, palmets, different kinds of palmets, various kinds of leaves, fan-shaped ornaments, different kinds of birds, vine leaflets, and a mixed group of ornaments. Well, when you cannot recognize what is going on, you will say the mixed group of ornaments. But actually, from geometrical point of view, from mathematician's point of view, this is not enough, because you will have for example, the same motif of the circle, they put them all together and somehow you see that it is not similar. Yes, there is a motif of circle, but somehow it is more connected with something else, not with other ornaments with circles. Actually, in her book, she wrote that she managed to classify all of them except, for example, 20. And that she just cannot put them anywhere because they do not belong anywhere from her point of view, so she put them beside. And then I look at these ornaments, find the church, where are they from, and make a comparison from mathematical and geometrical point of view, and they get their place in classification from mathematical point of view with no problem. So we should make these things together in order to get a really good classification. So there are three kinds of symmetry figures in plane from mathematical and geometrical point of view. These are rosette, friezes, and plane ornaments. We will talk only about plane ornaments. There are also space symmetry group. So we will just deal with plane symmetry groups. Rosettes are circular patterns. You find in some literature that it is not that rosettes are not included in ornaments because there is no repetition of the rosettes. But from geometrical point of view, it is about moving the dots in plane. So the rosettes are figures which can preserve a single invariant, unchanged point of the figure. Everything else is moving around, but you have one single point. If you have two single points, and that means that you have also the line, you will get friezes. Actually, instead of friezes, you can use the word border. But, for example, bordura is more connected with the clothes. Bordura. But friezes are used in, for example, church and architect, but they're usually going in vertical kind of line. So you get friezes, but also as the decorative kind of element which is going around, for example. And the plain ornaments, they are, these are petals without invariant points. They have two invariant directions. For example, friezes, they have one invariant direction. So this is the line which stayed under the transformation of the plane, which is transformed into itself. So let's take a look at what Zagorka Jans wrote about ornamental art in Serbia and Macedonia a little bit. She said that all ornaments in our fresco are painted very freely, almost imprecisely, usually with strong illusionistic tendencies. And this is true. Actually, they are not rigid, they are not really straight lines, really circles are not really circles. But as George Gleiser told you in his lecture about nature, it is not about that you have to have exact forms and to find really exact rules. It is more about some kind of freedom when you are painting things like this. Yes, today, nowadays you can easily use softwares and something like that to produce absolute regular structure. But as well as with our faces and our bodies, we don't like the perfect symmetry. It is no problem to find some circle which is done by three hands, so it is not going to be perfect, so what? Several distinct artists' influence can be found, this is what I mentioned. And also a very interesting book done by Vladimir Dvorniković. It is Characterology of Yugoslav. It has been published in 1939. And I found there an interesting point of view. He wrote that after the first lost battles against the Turks, the painting is a clearly visible new, rude, but strong natural stroke. And that after the Turkish occupation of Serbia, popular fresco painters, stone cutters, and engravers appear, which transformed all church art into the semi-popular art and craft. It is very interesting also from history point of view, and to follow where we can find that visible new rule but strong natural stroke. Because you know, when the Turk came, the kingdoms and everything go on the north. And who is going to do some new paintings in the church? Is it somebody from Byzantium or from Rome is going to come? Or whatever? Or the people will start to do it by themselves, thinking that I can do that, so you made a copy of that, but actually you're not well educated to do that. So you can find the difference in the quality of that artwork. It is clearly visible. This is why the new rude but strong natural stroke. So I just wanted to point on this because actually we can find a lot of interest, we can do a lot of interesting kind of investigation in that way of thinking. So let's start with roses. Roses, as I told, are decorative elements of a polygonal or circular shape. They are preserving the invariant point. It is the center of the rosette. There are some examples. The example from a mathematical point of view, of course, this is a square with horizontal and vertical line of symmetry with a diagonal. Also, we can follow which kind of symmetry we have. If we put some asymmetric C in this area here, and after that, it is with vertical symmetry move like this, and with the diagonal symmetry go like that, and so on. But what we have here, we have just rotation, so we excluded this mirror in vertical and horizontal line, and actually we made a kind of subgroup of this group, if we are talking from the point of view, from the point of symmetry group terms. So here we have the other group of the order form also here, and here we have a secret kind of group without a father. And also there is an example from Giovanni's writing. There is a plenty of different kinds of roses. I just take one slide of examples. From the left side we have a simple kind of things which can be used in Germany, of course. From the right side, different kind of crows that can be used. Because there is no culture, no country without using this kind of cross. Here you have some examples of variation of the symbol of the cross, of course. And it is easily now to recognize the differences between the symmetries they possess. For example, the first one only possessed the vertical violet symmetry. The second one is the similar as the previous one. The third one have vertical and horizontal line. And here you have also diagonal. So it depends on the measurement and relation between horizontal and vertical kind of cross that has been used. This is also known as Russian cross, and this is the usual way that we are using cross in our history of art. There are some more examples. These are examples from Holy Mother of Nieviska. This is the sign, the motif that I mentioned that has been used for the motif of exhibition. There are some beautiful examples of Krusha doll and Nagorchino. Most of the roses kind of things has been used just as a part of friezes or something like that, and they after that they were repeated in one or the other direction. We can see here that this motif is not so precise. For example, here, if you put a vertical line of mirror symmetry, you will see that the upper and lower part of the motif is not symmetric. But when you look at the motif as a whole, the impression that you have is that it is symmetric, like this and like this. And this is what we are going to remember without any rotation, just rectangular kind of symmetry. Vertical and horizontal. And yes, then you added some leaves or some details like that. So this is going on the left, this is going on the right. And if we want to be really honest and think from the mathematical point of view, we will say, oh, this is not symmetrical. This is not symmetrical because this part is not going to this part. We can do the rotation half turn, yes, there is a half turn, but actually, if you are going into such a kind of details, this part is not going to fit this one, so there will not be the half turn either. And after all, if you take a look on all these details, you will say, this is not symmetrical at all. It is not the truth. This is that visual kind of perception of things, because all of us, if I put it like Sunčica, just 2 seconds to look at this and ask you, was that motif symmetric? All of you will say, oh yes, it was vertical and horizontal line of symmetry. And this is the point when mathematicians should not be rigid and should take care about these kind of things. There is no such a kind of clear rules to do that in order to classify ornaments, so it just should be careful. The similar thing going on here. So there are two kinds of groups of roses. You are all mathematicians, so during your geometry study, you were able to hear about the other kind of groups and cyclic kind of groups, so I will not talk about it. There are some more examples from dresses and clothes of saints and kings. For example, this motif from Petkovic, similar like the Vorsov. Is this a square or it is not a square? It looks like it is. If you start to measure it, you say, oh no, it is not. There are 2 millimeters more on this side than on this side. But it is more about what was the intention of the artist who has done it. The intention was that it is symmetric. And that the central point, part is square, not a rectangle. And we can find a lot of these motifs on walls. Usually they are not too complicated. The more complicated with higher order of symmetry can be used in windows or something like that. But for the clothes, it is going to D4 or D6 or something like that. It is not going to higher order of symmetry. So, okay. Friezes. Friezes are figures that have an invariant direction. This is the axis of the translation. And every symmetry group of friezes can be denoted by the symbol. And this symbol consists of the elementary symbol. So, 1 is for trivial rotation of order 1. G is for light reflection. 2 is for rotation of order 2 of half turns. M is for mirror refraction, and as a result, we can get the notation, the crystallographic kind of notation, for 7 symmetric groups of friezes. So I will use on this presentation this notation. Actually, you can find different kinds of notation. So when you are using some books, first you should take a look at the explanation of the notation that's going to be used. So, every real frieze can be extended to infinity in 2 directions. 1 is to continue to frieze along its axis, so just on the left or on the right, or by making parallel copies of the original frieze, and in that way you're going to get the new ornaments. Here is one good example, actually, well, yes, my workshop is cancelled, but there are some things from this presentation that actually you can use if you want to do this something during your lessons about symmetry. For example, this is the warp, the flow diagram, how to recognize which symmetry groups we are talking about. So there is a question. Is there any vertical reflection on our frieze? If yes, we are going here. If no, we are going here. If yes, the second question, is there any horizontal reflection? If yes, this is the group MM. And as you can see, there is a repeated vertical reflection, and there is a horizontal reflection which must coincide with the axis of the frieze. More, if there is no horizontal reflection, you see the results here, there is no horizontal reflection, but there are 2 different kinds of groups. One is if there is a half turn like this, so you have half turn here and half turn here. But if there is no any half turn, you just got a simple repetition of asymmetrical motif at the beginning. So you have the black triangle, it is mirrored on this one, now it is mirrored on this one, and actually the whole frieze is can be turned on this vertical axis of reflection and going to itself. If there is no vertical reflection, look at these examples, none of them have any vertical reflection axis. So, but there are some more questions. Is there any horizontal? If yes, we have 2 possibilities. One is connected with the the question was horizontal reflection or glide line reflection. If there is, we can ask, is there any horizontal reflection? If it is, this is 1M group. If there is no, so it means that it was about the glide reflection. So here we have the glide reflection things. And if no, any horizontal horizontal or glide deflection. There are two possibilities. Actually, just the rotation without any mirror assist, vertical, horizontal, or anything. And the possibility to use the rotation of order 2, which is not the same as the half turn. This is the half turn. This is the rotation of order 2. Also, I want to use this picture to make the difference between these two groups. This is M1, this is 1M. Here we have a vertical mirror axis. Here we don't have that. Here we do not have horizontal mirror axis. Here we do. But actually, in plenty of freezes, we will find this, and it can be recognized not in a good way, because usually it is staying like this vertically. Because usually, if you can see in this kind of repetition, without, in this case, vertical mirror exists, you have indicated the kind of moving from right to left. If you imagine that this freeze is standing like this, this is the motif that usually can be found in a lot of church, because it is the connection between earth and the sky, and the God, between people and the God. So this is the kind of non-verbal communication, the direction of your feelings or your movements. So these non-verbal messages connected with direction of moving can also be used in design of halls, of underground, if you want to make a point in which direction you should go. You don't have to put just an ugly arrow, go this way. You can just put some nice tiles, which is going to say to you, go like this, and you will just follow that without knowing that you are doing something that you got unconsciously. So this is what I mentioned. There are some examples who possess polar axis, like in the previous example. And this made the suggestion of oriented motion. And also we have something like an anthropomorphic kind of forms, because this can go from right to left, or also if you turn it on, it can go from left to right. So there is no vertical reflection which is going to turn the whole freeze like this. But there can be two different kinds of direction. Is it on this side or this side? So actually, they are called enantiomorphical kind of symmetries, and they pointed out on directed motion. Okay, most of all I already mentioned. What is the point in fresco painting of medieval Serbia? It is possible to find all seven types of these friezes. This is not the most important things, but it is something that you should expect. There are only seven of them, seven different ways to repeat some motifs. So yes, we expect to find all of them, so we did. There are some examples. This is M1. This is some example from the book that can be easily recognized what is going on. And there are some examples from, for example, this one is from Peško Patriarche, but this one is from St. George from Kurpinova. And for example, this freeze can be, we can look at it like this, or to put it in a horizontal line, which is more normal in this situation, but I didn't have place on this slide, so this is why it is going from down to up. But you can see that the floral symbols, there is nothing like moving from down to the top, so it should be in horizontal kind of line. And this example could be used during your classes of symmetries, because you say, here you have a kind of repetition, here you can find the mirror exists, And it is not only about these two motives, it is about the whole phrase, it is going left side to the right and the opposite. But also, it is not only about these two motives, also you can find the mirror, vertical mirror axis on the curve of M. For example, group MM with the biggest order of symmetry, because you have here included all kinds of symmetry. As a subgroup, you can find all the others in it. So this is the example with asymmetric kind of motifs, and some geometrical shapes, and some shapes which are connected with just with the lines. But also, there is an example from Dečani monastery, and this is good to make comments about how we can recognize the kind of symmetry. If you look just in this motif, this is one rosette. This rosette possesses D4 symmetry groups because it is the symmetry group of the square. And here you can find the vertical and horizontal and the diagonal, and there is C4 as a subgroup and so on and so on. So the symmetry group of this particular rosette is C4. But after that, you can start to repeat, just moving in one direction, so you will get a freeze. And if you remember slides ago, there were no mention anything about freezes with a symmetry of order 4. There were all a symmetry of order 2. Why is that? If we say, oh, but this is D4, my freeze must be the same, in the same way, to possess the same symmetry. So, let's see. Those kind of symmetries must be applied to the whole freeze. So, if I say this freeze got symmetry D4, then it means that if I turn it like this rosette, you can turn it for 90 degrees like that, on the left or on the right. Can we move the whole freeze 90 degrees on the left or on the right? You will get this one. And what is the symmetry of the freeze? This is a transformation which will transform the whole freeze into itself, not in another one. So the freezes can possess the order of symmetry only of order 2. So these rosettes can possess the symmetry 4 or 8 or 12 or whatever, but the freeze itself cannot possess that order of symmetry. There's some more nice example, MG group. And this is the example that I mentioned in my introduction from Kalinic. This is the extension in the other direction, as the result gives some plain ornaments. So, for example, here, this one track, it is mixed with different kind of ornaments. You can look at this like that, but this is not connected with this one, this is not connected with this one. And it seems at first that this track is going here and going here. But look at the other way. This is one freeze. These are famous zigzag lines. Here is the other ornament. Oh, freeze, sorry. And the third one. And when we put them together, we can get structure like this. And this is the illusion that, okay, it's not, maybe it can be produced like this, but this itself is not a freeze. There is no symmetric relation between this part and this part. But each of it is freeze. And it is based on this phase and zigzag movements. The example from the border of the dress of from Bogorodice Karanska church with the group 1G with the glide reflection. With the group 1-2 from Sopočani, you can see this is the famous meandric kind of motif with the order of 2, because you have rotation of order 2 that can be recognized here. And I'm talking too much, plain ornaments. The third and the most beautiful and huge group of ornaments are plain ornaments. Usually when people say ornaments, they're thinking of plain ornaments, but actually we should make we should distinguish things between roses and frieses and ornaments. Okay, ornaments as plain ornaments. This is these are infinite plane patterns without invariant points. Nothing is going to stay in the place where it was before transformation. No invariant points, no invariant lines. They have two translation in different direction. So for example, here you have the simplest way of repetition, just from up to down and from left to right. But also there can be a different kind of repetition of basic motif. We can recognize from a mathematical point of view 70 different symmetry groups of ornaments. They are connected with something that we call crystallographic restriction for rotation. The similar one, well, not the similar one, for frieses we have the rotation of order 2. Here we have only rotation of order 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6. And this is an example from Bogorodica Jeviška. This is group P for M. Similar as frieses, each of 70 plane symmetric groups of ornament can be denoted by the corresponding symbol. What are those symbols? The first coordinate is the translational part of the symmetry group. And if it's connected, is it going to be in parallelogramic lattice? I will show you a picture later. Or rhombic lattice, which is noted by C. The second symbol represents reflection, M, which is perpendicular to the first translation axis of rotation. And the third symbol represents reflection or light reflection, G. So this is the picture of different kind of lattice that can be used to produce all this huge number of ornaments. And these are similar examples as for friezes about the ornaments with asymmetrical triangle, which is repeated in different way of the repetition. So we have for friezes we have translation only one direction, and here we have in two directions, so like this and like this. So the basic motif is the one that is repeated, and there are no other kind of symmetry. Here you can find the rotation of order 2. Here you can find vertical symmetry axis. Here is also with vertical symmetry axis, but as you can see, here we have something that is connected with parallelogramic or rectangular kind of grid. But here, if you just try to connect the repeated point, you will have different kind of lattice, like rhombic one. So this is CM, this is PM, and there are reasons to make different kind of notation, and visually they are really different. And also with two vertical horizontal mirror axes on the rectangular grid, and so on and so on. There is also a flow diagram which can be used for the teaching how to recognize which ornament we are talking about. It is good not because somebody should force anyone to recognize what is this, what kind of group. It is more connected with how to recognize which kind of symmetries has been used in the ornaments, and that ornament is somehow connected with our cultural treasure. So it is good examples to use that. So what we are using now, it is which is the smallest rotation, and rotation can be 0, 60, 120, 90, 180 degrees. After you recognize a rotation that your ornaments possess, after that there are some more questions. And going through this flow question diagram, you will get the answer which group is in question about. There are some examples of ornaments from our medieval fresco art. The first one is connected with group CM, the second with group P4M, the third one CMM, and so on. And there are plenty of examples. this is my really favorite one before. This is also very beautiful, PRG, and this one, P4G. Actually, we were not able, we've got a huge collection of ornaments, actually 5 gigabytes or something like that. And we tried to classify them and to make all this classification. We were not succeed to find these three kind of groups, P6, VGG, and P31M. Actually, we found this example, but it is kind of forced example, you know, when you find them as a subgroup or some other group, or doing just the deep effort just to say, oh, we found all of them. No, it was not used in Serbian fresco art, but it doesn't mean that this fresco art is not rich enough. Just on this slide, we have so many beautiful examples, variation of form, etc. So this is not so important. It can be important from a point of view how the culture were connected, to find out who used in that period of time, who used this kind of groups, and to find out if there were any connection between two countries or something like, or two kingdoms or something like that. Why we didn't, why cannot we find these kind of groups, you know, to make such a kind of investigation. Here we have a simplest example, PM. This is from Bogorodice Ljeviška on the left, and on the right, Manasija. The group PM is mostly basically connected with the multiplication of friezes. So, actually, you have a rosette. Rosette repetition produce frieze, and frieze just moving up and down and produce these ornaments. So there is a connection between rosettes, friezes, ornaments. But this is the basic repetition, and actually it looks like boring things. But actually this is the simplest way to produce ornaments, and it is used. Different kind of motifs can be used. Yes, this one is a heraldic kind of sign with eagles or something like that. There are some examples of CM group connected with Gračanica, Ljubosinja, Manasija, and so on and so on. This one is brilliant. Brilliant. I like it very much. Because there is no line between these diagonal movements. It is just a change of color that makes the illusion that we have something cylindric or something like that, and we can easily recognize these different strips. But actually, there is no any line here. It is just about the change of colors. Why CM? What is the connection about all these ornaments? Because, for example, if you ask someone who is connected with the history of art, what is the connection then? You say, stupid. Maybe this one, and this one. Well, this one, yes, but this one, no. This can be, but maybe. Because there are different kind of motifs from the kind of point of view of leaves, plants, geometric kind of shapes, and so on. So what is the connection? Here is very easily to recognize this rhombic grid in the background. And after that, you just can put some symmetric motifs in it. And after that, the whole group is changing. It depends what kind of motif you will put into it. Here you can easily recognize that grid, also here. Here you cannot, but you can imagine there is that grid. It is just not pointed out here with different colors, but actually, if you imagine this grid here, or just connecting this motif, you will recognize easily there is a connection. These are group P4M, some examples of them. What is the difference in for the previous one? In previous example, we have had, in previous example, it is about rhombic lattice, and here we have square lattice. So it is going to produce different kinds of ornaments. Actually, we have the basic group connected with the symmetry groups of square, or just the square lattice, but after we put some motifs in it, it is going to change. So this is connected with 5 minutes. This is connected with the process that we are calling symmetrization. What is symmetrization? For example, this is not that we are starting from some kind of grid. No, we are just starting with a single motif, and it can be and usually it is asymmetric figure, and it is we can surround it by its symmetrically arranged copies. And for example, this is how we can produce one rosette. And after that, you can surround your rosette with other copies of it, and so on and so on. So in symmetrization, you are starting from asymmetric figure, and after that, with the repetition, you don't have to have in mind which kind of symmetry you are going to use to produce all these ornament things, but it is easily, with basic repetition kind of things, you can make this. Usually, we are producing first roses, then friezes, then ornaments by repetition. This is the process that we call symmetrization, and it is it can easily can be recognized in such a kind of examples that we were able already to see. So you are starting. Actually, you will not start with asymmetrical part. You will start with the triangle with the flowers here, and after that you will repeat it. And so on. The other process is desymmetrization. So it was, we are starting for asymmetrical part and produce symmetrical ornaments. And what is about this desymmetrization? This is what I mentioned 2 slides before. We can start from the, for example, you just, if you wonder, how should I produce my ornament? What you're going to do? Well, let's say, let's draw a set of parallel line, and depending on this their arrangement and the angle between them, it can be square or it can be rectangular or it can be rhombic kind of lattice. And after that, this without motif possess his own symmetry group. But if I start to put symbols, maybe some symbol inside. I will get a different thing if I put asymmetrical things in each of these are squares, for example, or if I put symmetrical kind of things inside. So in order to see if the vertical axis, mirror axis, I will produce different kinds of groups. So, why this is desymmetrization? Desymmetrization sounds to be something bad. Well, the first thing is the square B, it possesses the symmetry groups P for M. But after that, we put asymmetrical motifs inside, so we don't have any more mirror axis, we don't have rotational order four. You cannot do anything with this ornament in order to transform it into itself. So what we have only translation into direction. So this is the ordinary one thing, P1. So what? We started for the high level of symmetry, P4M, and with adding asymmetric part into it, we put the symmetry down and got this P1 group. This method has been used very often with in ornamental art, because it is easy to start with a grid like this and just to choose the motif that you are going to put into this grid. So, for example, this is an example from the Bosnia. This is not the square grid, I think this is CM, and after that you put it the motif which possess the symmetry group, possess the vertical axis, so it is going to be CM. This is interesting, the animation of it was very beautiful on exhibition, because all of these things just going around each other, so on. So what is the dominant geometrical structure? It is from one side, it is P for M, but from the other side, because of this cross, we have P4. And different kind of motifs, if you start looking at the details, you will realize that there is no actually vertical mirror axis and so on, that it is put in the letter S, and which do not follow in the rotation, they're just translated on left, right. And that letter S possess only by itself possess the rotation of order 2 and so on. So the whole structure producing the really strong visual dynamic illusion, and all this decoration which are covering the sides of the crosses, they are disturbing the reflections, and they suggest the rotation of order 4 after all. So it was symmetrization, desymmetrization, and I will finish it. And who is interesting can contact me about the details about these things. I didn't mention the color things. So all what I mentioned until now, what is the symmetry of the outline shapes? But if we start talking about different kind of colors, believe or not, these are examples that I have found in period killings. They are very close connected with yin yang, and it is not because somebody from the east came into Serbia and teach them to about yin yang, but it is about dynamic of the nature, the opposite things that are in everyday life, male, female, up and down, left and right, good and evil, and so on. So the two color symmetry is very represented in our everyday lives much more than we can even imagine. So it was not such a big surprise that all these kind of motifs can be found with our period killings. And also there are some reconstruction and so on, just to see what was going on here. At first you have a square and his symmetry group, and this is D4. What is this C4? C4 is the symmetry group, for example, of the black part, because these black triangles going here, going here, going here. So if you take a look just at the black part of this rosette, it is C4. And this is the sign that we are using in algebraic geometry to denote the group, subgroup kind of things. And you know from the algebra that you are going to get the order of the subgroup into group. And basically, it means how many different colors you can see here in this basic example. You have two classes. One class is with white triangles, and the black. The other class is with black triangles. Also, the examples that you were able to see during my introduction, and also here. So what? If we don't care about colors, we will say, okay, I have vertical and horizontal kind of repetition. But if I say, oh, my green cannot go into my red motifs, then if we want to take care about the colors, the things are going to be a little bit different. Take a look on these red parts. They are not in the same way putting together. Here you have the simpler repetition on right, left, on the right angle, and if you take care about the singular color, you will get the group CM. So the sign of the notation of this group is PM by CM. Similar variation of the same thing is this ornament from Studenica. This is because when we have only two colors, we call them antisymmetry group. Antisymmetry is not asymmetry. Asymmetry is without symmetry. Antisymmetry means that, for example, black going is connected with white. So in that way, antisymmetry, because of the opposite kind of thing that I mentioned 2 slides ago. So this is the similar kind of things. And actually, almost all the examples in ornamental art are connected with color ornaments, not with uncolored. They are not rich and beautiful enough if you are using only one color. This one is very beautiful because if you can imagine that there is no this line here, that only this basic color has been used. You will get a nice ornament, basically nice, with the symmetry group P4M, and it is going to be with a high order of symmetry. But actually, if you add these colors here, for example, just this here, at first you had the symmetry of the square, D4, but by adding here this kind of line, you suggested the motion, the rotation. You don't have any more vertical or horizontal axis, mirror axis, but you have rotation. So you introduce, but just a simple kind of colors, you can suggest the motion in it. And the last thing that I'm going to mention is superposition, because basically mostly all of the ornaments are the composition of several, because you have one ornament with this motif, and the other with this circle, and the third one with these dots. So as that you are doing with three layer and put them together, and after all you produce such a kind of ornament. And after all, there are two kinds of colors for these dots. What is the final symmetry group of the ornaments? It is the Mutual subgroup of all of these three ornaments. So all the symmetries that are connected with all of these three ornaments. There are some examples from Manassia. You can easily recognize the black and the gold part. Actually, here we have three different kinds of them. For example, the ornaments on the right, superposition of three ornaments. P4M is for the black part. CMM from the golden rosette D4, and CMM of the golden rosette D2. So here we have the golden rosette D4, here we have the golden rosette D2. And after all, we have superposition of P4M, CMM, and another one, CMM. This is the picture from the exhibition. One of them, there are small tables like this, and it was really beautiful. And there are two slides where I put it together, different kinds of ornaments, all of them that do not possess the same symmetry group, but all of them are based on the square grid P4M. So you are starting on the grid like this and put some motifs into it, or changing the shapes of this basic lattice or grid, you can produce different kinds of ornaments. And as you can see, some of them are very similar. This is fresco painting, so there must be very rigid rules how to produce them and so on. But for example, this one is somehow different from all the other kinds of ornaments. And actually, it depends on the period of time when it was produced, about the colors and everything. So they do not have the same symmetry group, but they are based on the same square lattice P4M. All of these on this slide are connected with rhombic grid CMM. And these are very beautiful examples, also with just putting some different color, line color at the border to get the impression of 3D moving, of 3D, of the three dimension. You're just going up from the 2D dimension and the plane ornaments into three dimensional kind of things. So we have produced this illusion of 3D space, and also get different kinds of 3D effects, like on this one, and so on. So what is the conclusion for all of us, that we can use our treasure in modern kind of things, to include into modern technology? Also, that in spite of the relatively strong given rules coming from religious and symbolical function of ornaments, that we have a really wide and rich base of different kind of ornaments, very nice, and they are perfectly balanced in the sense of the form and colors. Some of them are more or less beautiful and so on, but artistic quality, impressive simplicity and visual power is an invitation to learn from them, to refresh our memory, and to try to use them as an inspiration for the future art creation.